Hello everyone, my name is Simone Griffioen and I work at the Netherlands Railways, and there I am concerned with the support for the use of OR models in planning. I will today tell you something about a change that we made in the way that we measure the service quality. But first I will tell you a bit about the Netherlands Railways. And also, it's actually, I really was looking forward to seeing you all in Berlin, but unfortunately that's not possible. But because I do like to talk for a live audience, I invited some people here. However, afterwards you can ask your questions and I will answer them live online as well. So the railways in the Netherlands. The Netherlands is quite a small country, but we do have a lot of rail compared to the size. So we have 7,000 kilometers of railways and over 1 million passenger trips a day. So you can imagine it's quite a dense network. In the Netherlands, the infrastructure management and the operations are split. So we have one company for the infrastructure management and we have multiple for the train operations. However, NS, where I work, is the biggest one and we operate 85% of the passenger lines. And today I will talk about the rolling stock planning. So what is rolling stock planning? We have a timetable in which we have a lot of trains, but we do need to decide which rolling stock we use for which train. So we have different rolling stock types, 9 in total, and these are 3 examples. And in total we have 700 rolling stock units, and the question for the rolling stock planning is which composition of rolling stock units should we use on which trip? So you can connect them together to make a longer train. So why is this a complex puzzle? Well, in the Netherlands we have a cyclic timetable. So that means that every hour we have the same amount of trains. So the capacity is not managed by changing the number of trains, but by changing the length of the trains. Well, we also have a lot of constraints. So for example, you cannot change the composition of the train anywhere you want. You need a you need someone to drive the train to connect it or to disconnect it from another rolling stock unit. But also the train cannot be as long as you want. Of course, the train cannot be longer than the shortest platform that you pass. Otherwise, the passengers don't fit in the train and they will fall out. And we don't want that. Well, when we do the rolling stock planning, we do have some objectives. So we don't want the train tickets to become too expensive. So we do want to take into account the costs of the plan. And we do want to maximize the service quality. So in of course there are multiple things that are good for passengers and that give passengers good service, but in rolling stock planning the most important one is the fact that people want to have a seat and want to have space in the train. So to help planners with this complex puzzle, we developed a tool. It's called TAM. And it was in-house developed and it's a mixed integer programming model and it's solved by CPLEX of IBM. And it's now used since 2011 in production. And in 2016 we moved the maintenance outhouse to Ortec. And in essence, in the model we have trips and composition, and for every trip we assign exactly one composition subject to the constraints and trying to maximize, of course, our objectives. And in this model, one of the objectives is the service quality. And I will now first show something about the old way that we measured it. So we had a KPI for the service quality and it was called passenger capacity. And for that KPI, the capacity that we use for the trains that differed per time of day. So in some times of the day we used only seat capacity, or we counted only the seat capacity. But on short trips, in rush hours, also the standing spots in the train were included in the capacity. And for this KPI, it was good if the passengers fitted in the allocated capacity, and it was not good if it did not fit. So for example, you have this train going from the airport. Well, one train is going from the airport to Rotterdam. It takes 16 minutes. So standing spots are not included. And the other train is going from the airport to Amsterdam. That takes only 14 minutes, so standing spots are included there. Now, suppose that we have 10 standing passengers on the trip to Amsterdam and one standing passenger on the trip to Rotterdam. And now we have one extra rolling stock unit available and we can choose where to use it. Well, to improve the KPI, we should use it on the trip to Rotterdam, so the trip on the right-hand side, to give this one passenger a seat instead of these 10 passengers. Well, you can already feel that this, you probably would make a different choice. So how does this actually work in planning? In planning, of course, we don't know the number of passengers beforehand. So we use a forecast, and what we used was the forecast of the demand, namely the 90th percentile. And for the capacity, we counted the allocated capacity, including the standing spots where needed. And the quantification of the service quality, we added up a dissatisfaction per trip. So some kind of service pain per trip. And this pain was defined by the shortest kilometers. So that's the distance of the trip times the number of passengers in the demand that did not fit or that do not fit into the allocated capacity. So for an intuition about this is that in 90% of the cases, this allocated capacity will be enough for the actual number of passengers. So you can maybe see that there are multiple kind of strange things happening. First of all, this very rigid bound of the 50 minutes, but also using the 90th percentile and not using the other information. And this makes it kind of impossible to make subtle trade-offs between different trips and different choices. However, up until 10 years ago, the most important input for the forecast of the number of passengers was the estimates by train managers. So I don't know if you have ever tried to estimate the number of people in a room or even harder in a train. Most people are not really good at that. So therefore the forecasts were also not that accurate. So it didn't make a lot of sense to have a much more fine-tuned KPI, because in the end it wouldn't really matter on the output. However, since 2012 there's a new payment system, an electronic payment system with a chip card, and with that a lot of anonymous data became available about the trips that people make, and also we could make much better forecasts with it. So this gave a possibility to use a better improved KPI. So what do we do now? Now we only use the seat capacity and we don't use the standing spots. And as the demand, we now use the whole probability distribution, so not only the P19. So we use a random variable, and for the quantification of the service quality, we still add up the service pain per trip. But now it's defined differently. So it's now the number of expected standing minutes. So we calculate what the expected number of standing passengers is, and we multiply by the duration of the trip. And we try to minimize this expected number of standing minutes over all the country actually. So in the model, first we had to minimize the total shortest kilometers, so that was linear in terms of the decision variables. And now we minimize the expectation of the total number of standing minutes. So it looks a little bit like a stochastic program. But the good news is that we don't have any recourse action, so actually the model stays the same. We only have a different definition of the pain, but it's still linear in terms of the decision variables. So what does it do with the outcome? Well, of course, the plan changes because it has to change to get to have a better service quality. But with a small amount of changes, we actually have a significant decrease in the planned standing minutes. So we have a better service without making more costs. So that's actually what we wanted, and we were very happy with that. So you would say, well, the model doesn't change that much. The plan changes a bit, but positively. That won't be any problem to implement, right? Well, I will show you that we did still have face quite some challenges, and I cannot tell you about all of them, but I will take you through some of them. So one is that the KPI that we had beforehand was quite black and white. It was either within the 50 minutes or not. It was either the P90 fitted or it did not. It was very clear when it was good and when it was not good. And now we have much more a sliding scale, because a lot of trips have some expected standing minutes, because you never know how many passengers there will be. Therefore, it's harder to do it by hand, and you need the optimization much more. And planners, a planning employee, we call it planner. So planners also need to trust the optimization much more, and that's quite a step to make. I've seen, well, a planner came to me, I'm trying to calculate these expected standing minutes, but he was using the P90, so that's really hard. So of course that didn't work. So at some point you need to just trust the optimization, and you cannot calculate everything and control everything anymore. So that was hard. And something quite remarkable was actually, well, I already hinted about it a little bit before. Of course, the plan has to change to become better. But even managers who knew this and were, this was the reason that they wanted it, they were still quite surprised. Like, oh, what? The plan changes. Oh, help. What's happening now? So that was quite funny, actually. Something else is that, well, in total, the service quality improved. But beforehand, it was more clear where we had bad service and where we had good service. So the bad service was on the short trips, and everyone knew that, so people didn't complain that much because they were used to very bad service. And now it was more spread out over the country, and therefore people did not expect to have sometimes a little bit worse service. So we also had to manage those expectations, and we actually made a small movie to explain how this worked. For the next thing, I actually want to start with an analogy. So we put something new in place. So suppose we buy a new sofa. You remove the old sofa, but behind the sofa there's a lot of dust and dirt, and you place a new sofa, but well, you first want to clean up the dirt, but people say, hey, you are trying to place a new sofa and you made all this dirt. Well, of course we did not make it, but you find out about things that were there before, but you made it clear that they are there. So one of these things was actually the changing forecast to enforce composition. So take this train, it has 399 seats, and now suppose we have a P90 of 350 passengers. You would say, that's no problem, that fits into the number of seats, so it's fine. But then people start complaining in the train, it's kind of crowded, I don't like it. And we have this department that is concerned with these complaints and has to handle them. And they think, well, how can we change this? How can we help these people? We just change the forecast and say that there are 400 people in the train. Ta-da, problem solved. Planning department plans a longer train. No problem, everyone happy. However, with this new service KPI, this doesn't work anymore because we don't have these rigid rules anymore. No, we have more the sliding scale, and even if you make the whole probability distribution higher, then still you cannot be sure that a longer train will be planned because we weigh the one train against the other, so it might still be that another one gets the longer composition. So this was actually one of the examples of something that a lot of people didn't know that we were doing, and because we changed this method, this actually became clear, and we now found a different way to handle this situation. So one more thing was that we were trying to do the implementation. Well, we saw the work schedule, we thought, well, if we do this at this point, then we will be completely in time. But apparently there was some kind of schedule, shadow schedule, and people said, well, yeah, officially you're in time, but I already worked ahead and I anticipated what you would give me, but now you're giving me something that I didn't anticipate, so no, you're completely, you're much too late. So this was also quite remarkable. Well, we did face a lot of more challenges, but I will not talk about all of them. But in the end, I think it was a success, and most important factors in that was that we had very strong management support. So, of course, you will face some challenges, and we did, but they really believed in what we were doing and also why we wanted it, so they also gave us the chance to find solutions for these challenges. Another important thing is the early involvement of planners and the continuous support available, so that they also felt like their concerns could be addressed, and that they were also taken with us in this new method. And another thing is that while we're doing this implementation, we did also change tooling to help the planners with other work that was annoying for them, because then they felt like, oh well, we're doing this together, we try to make everything better together, and that also made them more enthusiastic about making this change. And the last thing is that sometimes we had to compromise, so the new method was much harder to grasp for planners, what it did and how the plan changed, so we had to cut up the puzzle into smaller pieces so that they were able to understand what was happening there. And we did lose a little bit of optimality there, but we did win a lot of willingness to change and also, understanding about the method. So you can ask, are we there yet? I do think that we really have had a success. And one of the things that I'm most proud of is the fact that standing minutes, 5 years ago, nobody had ever heard of that. And it's also quite a complex concept, actually. But now, people in all parts of the company are talking about standing minutes. It's really become a household name. It's used in more and more places, in decision dashboards. There are budgets made of it. People are saying, no, we don't want too many standing minutes, and that's actually really cool that it really became a concept that people embraced. And another success is that we actually improved the actual passenger service in operation, and I think this new KPI really contributed to that. However, we can still improve things. For example, the long-term planning doesn't use standing minutes, so the transition from the long-term planning to the short-term planning can still be improved. And also, still remnants of the old KPI can be found in the mindsets of people. So sometimes people are still talking about these standing spots, and especially when they run into some difficulties or some problems, then sometimes they want to go back to the old KPI and they need support from us how to deal with these problems in the new context and with the new KPI. So with all of that, we do still have a job, but I'm actually happy with that because I really like to do this. Thank you.